Oh, well, hello there. My name's Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City, where the days are getting shorter, the temperature's getting colder, and that means there can only be one season in the air. That's right. It's application season for residency and fellowship, and I thought this would be the perfect opportunity for me to procrastinate on my own fellowship application and make a video highlighting all of the subspecialties of anesthesiology. Anesthesia fellowships are all typically 1 year and are not required to do anesthesia, but if you want to practice a certain subspecialty of anesthesia, can be necessary or at least very helpful for the job. In this video, I'm going to be discussing the most common fellowships in anesthesiology, which include cardiac anesthesia, critical care, obstetric anesthesia, pain management, pediatrics, and regional anesthesia. At the end of the video, I'll also mention some of the less common but also very interesting fellowships that are available for anesthesiology graduates. If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you liked it and subscribed to the channel. Without further ado, let's dive in. The first subspecialty I'd like to talk about is cardiac anesthesia. And of course, in order to talk about that, I have to be sitting in front of a cardiopulmonary bypass machine and put on my heart scrub cap. Cardiac anesthesiologists receive special training not only for cardiac surgery, but also for thoracic surgery as well as vascular surgery. There are special types of equipment that are used commonly in cardiac anesthesia, and of course that includes a cardiopulmonary bypass machine that's operated by a perfusionist. And then from the anesthesia side of things, it's very common to use transesophageal echocardiography and also to use pulmonary artery catheters, which are not frequently seen in other types of surgeries. It's very common in cardiac anesthesia to be placing big types of invasive lines, for example, central lines and arterial lines, and it's common to be using big types of pressors, which you can see more about in this video that I made detailing a cardiac anesthesia setup. Some of the aspects of cardiac anesthesia that attract people to the field include doing the procedures that I just mentioned, as well as working with patients who tend to be very sick. Patients undergoing cardiac surgery tend to have pretty severe cardiac or pulmonary pathophysiology. So people who go into cardiac anesthesia become extremely comfortable working with patients who are quite ill. One of the other aspects of cardiac anesthesia that's very unique is going on cardiopulmonary bypass, which often entails stopping a patient's heart entirely and rerouting their blood to go through this machine to get oxygenated and ventilated. That's something that's not frequently seen outside of cardiac operating rooms. Okay, I think we can put this away and we'll move right along. Next up is critical care medicine, which is a one-year fellowship that allows anesthesiologists to take care of patients in the ICU. And typically this entails being in the surgical ICU or in the cardiothoracic ICU. So these are patients who are either about to undergo surgery or are being managed in the post-surgical setting. One analogy that I find interesting is that working in an operating room is actually very similar to working in an ICU, with the difference being that in the operating room, you're taking care of one patient at a time, whereas an ICU can commonly have 6, 8, 10, or more patients. A lot of the same type of equipment is used, for example, ventilators, and a lot of the same medications are used for sedation purposes, and a lot of the same procedures are done like arterial lines, central lines, intubations, and so forth. It's not uncommon for critical care anesthesiologists to split their time between working in the ICU and also working as an anesthesiologist in the operating room. One of the aspects of critical care anesthesia that I grappled with that sort of steered me away from the field is the distinct lack of chairs and places to sit throughout the working day. I'm just kidding. Kind of. Next up is obstetric anesthesia, and as a resident, I actually get quite a bit of exposure to obstetric anesthesia, but the reason why someone might want to pursue a fellowship in it is so they can get specialized training in taking care of the particularly sick patients who come in when they're pregnant. The types of illnesses that obstetric anesthesiologists deal with commonly include bleeding disorders, neurologic disorders, or cardiac issues, among a host of other types of disorders that can complicate the anesthesia that's given during pregnancy. Obstetric ORs are pretty unique for a number of reasons. The first is that patients are typically awake during C-sections, although that's not always the case. And the other is that a patient's often accompanied by somebody who wants to be there during the C-section, and so we have a place for that person to sit. One really important aspect of obstetric anesthesia training is becoming very facile with volume resuscitation in the event of rapid blood loss, which is rare but can happen either during C-section or after delivery. In these types of situations, we have to be familiar with the medications that we can safely administer that are going to increase uterine tone to decrease the amount of bleeding. And the other aspect of it is to be able to deliver a large amount of fluids and specifically blood products in a short period of time, which can be done using a device called a Belmont rapid infuser. Which brings me to my last point about obstetric anesthesia training, which is there's a big focus on blood transfusion medicine because it's particularly important in this field. Next up is pain management, and just trying to figure out where to go. I'm a little out of my element here. There are like carpets and exam rooms and stuff. Yeah, fluoroscopy. We're heading in the right direction. So, as you can tell, pain management is very different from OR anesthesia, principally because this is an office-based practice, but there are a lot of procedures that go on, which is a big reason why people enjoy doing pain management. And I just stepped into the fluoroscopy suite, which is primarily where pain management specialists practice. Unlike OR anesthesia, where technically anesthesiologists are consultants to the surgeons, the pain management specialist is a primary doctor who sees their own patients in an outpatient setting and then can go ahead and do procedures here. As you can see behind me, fluoroscopy is used for pain management interventions so that the specialist can see exactly where they're injecting medication. The types of interventions that are done in pain management are very specialized and intended to treat longer-term chronic pain issues, as opposed to the types of interventions that are typically learned during anesthesia residency, which are more focused on the perioperative period, meaning immediately before, during, and after surgery. Next up is a subspecialty that's very near and dear to my heart, as well as the application deadline for fellowship, which is pediatric anesthesia. I think the best way to summarize pediatric anesthesia is with the old expression that kids aren't just small adults. And what that means is that pediatric patients have very unique anatomy and physiology, which makes caring for them pretty different from taking care of adult patients. For that reason, there's even a whole array of pediatric equipment that necessitates its own cart, as seen right behind me next to the adult anesthesia cart. One of the other aspects of pediatric anesthesia that can seem intimidating is that when problems do arise, they tend to arise very quickly because pediatric patients have a much lower functional reserve than adult patients on average. While general anesthesiologists receive training in taking care of pediatric patients, it's not uncommon for hospitals to have board-certified pediatric anesthesiologists to take care of the very young patients or pediatric patients who are undergoing particularly complex surgeries. I'll also point out that there's even more specialized training that one can receive after doing pediatric anesthesia fellowship, which is doing pediatric cardiac anesthesia, which focuses exclusively on cardiac surgery for pediatric patients. Of course, one of the prerequisites for doing pediatric anesthesia is having an affinity for bubblegum. The last of the more common subspecialties I'll cover is regional anesthesia and acute pain medicine. This subspecialty is focused primarily on doing nerve blocks, which can range from spinals to epidurals to brachial plexus blocks, lumbosacral plexus blocks, and all different kinds of nerves. Pretty much, if there's a nerve that you can block, regional anesthesiologists can block it. One of the principal tools that regional anesthesiologists use is an ultrasound like this one, which can be used to easily visualize neurovascular structures so that a needle that's injecting local anesthetic can be visualized during its entire trajectory, making regional anesthesia quite safe. Among the benefits of doing regional anesthesia include providing less systemic anesthesia, which can be particularly helpful when taking care of patients who have very severe systemic disease and might not be able to tolerate a deep plane of general anesthesia. Another benefit of regional anesthesia is for longer-term pain relief that can last hours or even days after surgery is done. While performing blocks for regional anesthesia is a part of any general anesthesiologist training, the subspecialty training that regional anesthesiologists receive is second to none. And because I went through the trouble to get an ultrasound to have as a prop in this video, I might as well just show you what my brachial plexus looks like. So, for example, if I wanted to have surgery on my upper arm right now, I could inject local anesthesia into this nerve bundle right here in what would be called a supraclavicular block. In addition to the fellowships I've already mentioned, there are quite a few other options available for anesthesiologists as well. Those include liver transplant anesthesia, and you can actually check out a video that I made showing the anesthesia setup for a liver transplant case. There's anesthesia for ENT, which focuses on head and neck pathology, for example, difficult airways. There's anesthesia for neurosurgery, and you can actually check out a video that I made where I interviewed the director of the neuroanesthesia program at Mount Sinai Hospital. There's also international and global health, perioperative and ambulatory medicine, palliative and hospice care, addiction medicine, simulation, and clinical informatics. I've included links in the description below if you want to find out more information about any of these fellowships. Well, that wraps up this video, and I should probably get back to working on my own application for pediatric anesthesia fellowship. So thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.